The NFL today is one of the biggest sports events in the world, and with its changes and evolution of its players and rules, the game is hard to imagine it any other way. When you think about it, the game was massively different 10 years ago, and the farther you go back, the more unrecognizable the game appears to be. 20 years, 30 years, 50 years, but what about 100? What was the NFL really like 100 years ago? Well,
let's find out. 1, 2, 3.
Hello everybody, I am Mark the Great, and in today's video we are going back to 100 years and see what the National Football League was like in the 1920s, specifically 1921, and around that period. This was known as the NFL Rag Days, the beginning part of the league, and saying that it was a whole different league would be the biggest understatement of 2021, but I researched the NFL back then, and I will do my best to accurately depict the NFL during its earliest period. I will be going over a lot of stuff in this video, so if you happen to learn something new or like the video, then please consider leaving a like on this video as it helps this video get out to more people and it helps a lot more than you think. Also, if you happen to be new to the channel and like to see other stuff, consider subscribing to this channel. I post videos like these all the time and you do not want to miss out. It's free, so why not? If you happen to, be sure to hit the notification bell as well, so it's guaranteed you'll be notified. Anyways, let's get started. Okay, so actually one more quick thing to mention. I will not be showing any clips or video of the 1921 season, and the only reason why is because, well, it doesn't exist. The game was not televised yet until the late 30s, and even pulling up that footage is extremely difficult because there was not a lot of film in that time. So I do apologize here to see any modern clips here. It's just not too, there's not too much I can do here, but I will try to use some pictures as well, but those are extremely hard to find as well. So with that being said, let's press on. The year 1921 was the NFL's second season of existence, and it was a complete mess to say the least, but let's start out with the name. Yeah, it was not called the NFL at all. It was actually called the American Professional Football Association, or APFA for short. It won't be called the NFL for another year in 1922. Now that is established, let's talk teams. During the 1921 season, specifically, there were a total of 21 teams at the start of this NFL season, or should I call it the APFA season? Actually, believe it or not, a lot of these teams did not even make it past two games before dropping out of the league entirely. These teams were not the New England Patriots or the Chicago Bears or any of the 32 teams we all know, but teams like the Rock Island Independents, the Hammond Pros, the Muncie Flyers, the Detroit Tigers, the Washington Senators. I could go more into these teams, but I'm not going to name all 21 of these teams, so here is a list of all of them. Out of all the 21 teams at the time, half of them did not even play a whole season either because of insufficient funds or they just flat out folded. The other 8 teams did not even last more than 2 years. The only teams that even made it out of those 2 years was the Chicago Cardinals, the Green Bay Packers, which 1921 was their first season, and the Chicago Stanleys, who later got renamed multiple times until it got called the Chicago Bears during the late 1920s, but we are not there yet. The two top dog teams were the Buffalo All-Americans and the Chicago Stanleys, who were both 9 wins at the time, although there was some controversy in the title game, but more on that later. Also, the scheduling during the 1921 season was a complete mess as well. Now, games during this time were not based off of predetermined dates and times. It was literally off the fly, almost like the one team challenging another, and that's how it went. This was also why some teams folded as well. During the 1921 season, many teams played exhibition games against one another. Many of these games did not count towards their record at all, and the only ones that did matter were these divisional rival games. Now, in order to play these divisional rival games, the other team literally has to accept the challenge in order for the game to even be played. This essentially meant that the bad teams and the newly formed teams could not play with the other well-established teams, and believe me, I am using this very loosely, and thus cannot get fans or support, so they inevitably folded. This is why when you look at the standings during the 1921 season, some teams have more games played than others. Now, I know this sounds complicated, and believe me, it was complicated, but hopefully I explained it well enough for you. But if you happen to not fully understand, go ahead and ask any comments below and I'll try to answer them as soon as possible. I will also have links for more explanations in the description as well. Okay, so as far as how the games actually went themselves, this was very difficult to find out just because there was no footage, but the good thing is that there are documents going over the basic rules of the game back then. For those who do not know, it was college rules. So that should at least give you an idea of what a game would look like during the 1921 season. But one thing we do know about this era was the equipment. The CTE rules was never a thing at all, neither was face mask or the helmet in the most cases. Yes, this is true. Many players chose not to wear helmets at all due to them being way too hot inside of them, and the ear flaps of the helmets could not allow them to hear plays as well. As for players who did wear helmets, they were all the same color around the league, which is this ugly butt cheek brown. So there was no design on the helmets yet, as you have to wait around another 10 years to get designs on the helmets to do so. And as for protection wise, these helmets were literally just a piece of leather on your head and provided no protection from concussions or any kind of head damage at all. They just looked ugly. As for when play calling is concerned, it was not like your average NFL game with regular run plays and passing plays. It was literally like a game of rugby. However, there were lines of scrimmages, first downs, and whatnot. But instead of four downs, there was three, and the formations were very outside the box, to say the least. Players were able to do multiple laterals, make unnecessary hits, and the formations were as complicated as plays on the yard. But if you went to an actual game, you would be able to recognize the game, for the most part at least, just, you know, it would look really, really whack. Many games during the 1921 season were not played in a stadium, but most likely a park. A seat at a game would cost around $1.75 to $2, depending on where you're at. You're going to, the audience would be around about 2,000 to 5,000 people would fill up the seats, which was a lot more than I thought, and there was no televised game, so you wouldn't be able to watch it at your house at all. Now, coming back to the teams, the only two teams that really mattered during the 1921 season was the Buffalo All-Americans and the Chicago Stanleys, like I mentioned earlier. And since both of these teams had 9 wins, they decided to play their own championship. Now, the crazy thing is that there was no such thing as a playoff game or a Super Bowl or even an NFL championship game at all. All the teams in the league would literally vote on who should be that year's champion. That's it. When I was researching this, I thought this was some kind of joke, but no, it was real. Despite this, the Buffalo All-Americans did end up playing against the Chicago Stanleys in their championship game, and the Stanleys ended up winning the game 10-7. However, there did seem to be some kind of controversy regarding this, because the Stanleys and the All-Americans played on Thanksgiving Day earlier that year, and the Stanleys lost, and the head coach of the Stanleys, George Halas, had the game not count towards this for the standings list. It made the second game count, which was the 10-7 win for the Stanleys, and they ended up winning the whole thing. And the All-American fans did not like this at all and found this to be cheating. If you happen to live during this time, you would most likely be talking about this event, as it apparently been a huge conversation amongst the football fans during that time. Anyway, champions would not get a ring or a massive trophy, but they would get an award called the Silver Loving Cup, and each player on the winning team would receive a golden fobs on this in the shape of a football inscribed with the words World Champions on it. So not exactly a ring, but something close to it. And there you go, an overview of the 1921 season. I know it was complicated and there was a lot to understand here, but let's just say that it was a complicated mess back then. But overall, as the years went on, the game ended up getting improved up to the point where we're at today. Although not much is known about the football during the rag period, the little information we do know shows us that the NFL humbled its beginnings, as it gave us room for the sport to blossom and improve, and it will keep improving to years to come. Thank you all for watching this video. I hope you all liked the video. This one was a hard topic to cover just because of all the little knowledge we know about this sport. But I tried to do the best I can to give you all and myself a perspective on the NFL what was like 100 years ago. Comment down below on your thoughts of the NFL 100 years ago. I would love to hear what you think in the comment section below. And also, if you happen to like this video, then consider giving this video a like rating, and do not forget to subscribe to the channel as well. Thank you all for watching, take care, and have a good day.